the audience to you. So this is the audience which have been like supporting and wanting to know a lot about our natural farming techniques and whatever projects we do, whatever models that we have developed. We have a group of like around 1,000, 2,000 people who regularly message me and asking me to conduct some sessions for them. So this is the audience. I mean, this is a really like a loyal community who want to work towards better environment and good farming practices. So thank you audience for the support that you have been giving to us. We'll start the session at 6:30. Till then, we'll just let you know what we'll be doing the session. So Prabhakar, we'll start with some videos at 6:30 or whenever we start the session, whenever we have people in the meet. After that, we'll be doing a Q&A session. Can you just let me know if my voice is audible? You can put in the chat box. You can just give a thumbs up in the chat box. Let me know if the voice is audible. Okay. ठीक है, आई थिंक द वॉइस इज ऑडिबल. सो आई जस्ट टेल यू वॉट द सेशन इज अबाउट. 6:30 वी डू अ क्विक वीडियो सेशन विद डॉक्टर प्रभाकर राव. डॉक्टर प्रभाकर जी ने ही हैज लाइक टॉट लैक्स ऑफ फार्मर्स, ही हैज ट्रेन लैक्स ऑफ फार्मर्स इन द नेचुरल फार्मिंग टेक्निक्स एंड ही इज एक्सपर्ट. इट्स लाइक वी आर रियली ब्लेस्ड दैट वी हैव एक्सपर्ट लाइक डॉक्टर प्रभाकर राव with us, who have been helping every one of us, and especially me for all the requests that I gave it to him. So he will go with a couple of, or maybe like few videos to start with. We'll do a quick Q&A session with Dr. Prabhakar Rao from the questions that you have sent to me. So there were some questions which I received through the Google form. We'll go through the questions, the most relevant ones. And post that the session would be open for you to ask the questions. You can put your questions in the chat box. The most relevant and the appropriate questions will be selected and we'll ask the same questions to Dr. Prabhakar Rao. So for today's, this is the agenda. We'll do a quick video session with him. We'll do a quick Q&A session from the questions that you have sent to me. And meanwhile, you can also post your questions in the chat box so that could be answered as well during the session. So we have 2 minutes to start the session. Prabhakar ji, if you want to tell something, we have a workshop also with Prabhakar ji, the upcoming workshop. So Prabhakar ji, if you want to tell something to the audience for next 2-3 minutes, we can do that and then we can start the session.
Not really. I will be speaking to them for about 45 minutes. So maybe you could speak about what Art of Living is doing in terms of the environmental efforts and what we are doing for natural farming, water conservation. Maybe a few topics there you could touch, Rahul.
Sure. So a lot of you are already a part of the Art of Living family. There can be few of you who are not a part of like Art of Living family or who don't know about the projects that we do. So I'm like really glad to tell you that we have been working a lot in the environment space. It from river rejuvenating rivers to conserving water to doing natural farming, training farmers in natural farming techniques to promoting a plastic-free society. So for each of these project heads, we have like multiple teams working on it. So just to give you a quick idea, I'll just throw some numbers that you know that, oh, this is the level of work that we have been doing. And it's all connected actually. Agriculture and water both are connected. These are the resources that we need to take care of. So I'm really, really glad to share that our river regeneration team has been reviving like 47 rivers in India, in 4 states of India, which is Tamil Nadu, Karnataka, Kerala, and Maharashtra. So going forward, we have been doing a lot of natural farming sessions. If somebody or like if any one of you are interested in doing something around water conservation or around reviving rivers, we can do that as well. We can explore working under various projects that we do. So this is the plan going forward. We would be expanding to teach you other workshops as well. It can be rainwater harvesting workshop or similar kind of workshops. So this is the amount of work that we have been doing. We have been reviving 47 rivers in India. In natural farming terms, I have already shared that Prabhakar ji and his trust have trained around 22 lakh farmers in India in natural farming techniques all over in all the states of India almost. So these are the farmers who have been making a lot of difference after learning this technique. I want to share some stories from Maharashtra where I personally visited. So there were farmers who, I mean, it was like a drought hit district and the farmers weren't making any money. It was like a dead situation for them. But after learning our techniques, the techniques that we taught them to make agni, to make enzymes and other fertilizers at home, so the cost that they were spending for their whatever fertilizers that reduced, and they were making profits from the remaining amount. So we have reached to 22 lakh farmers. This is the level of work that we have been doing. And I don't know if a lot of people know about it. So we have been working in rivers. We have been training farmers. We have been promoting plastic-free society. So our SSRDP trust, which is a rural development trust, they have installed machines which can convert plastic to fuel. And also they have installed few machines in temples where a lot of waste generates. So that machines convert waste to compost. So we have installed these machines in 17 temples of India. And if I go by the number, the capacity of these machines is to turn 14 lakh of waste into compost, which is again used by farmers in their field. So whatever projects we have been doing, it's like related. So if you want any information about our projects, you can get in touch with me. For now, we have been doing a lot about agriculture and supporting agriculture techniques. But if you want to know more about our projects, if you want to learn more about our different projects that we do, we can explore that as well. So we'll talk about the projects later. Prabhakar, if you want to start the session, we can do it.
Yeah, I will do that. Just give me a minute. I'll do it. Shall I do a screen share and start?
Sure, Prabhakar.
Up. Done. Can you spotlight you and me?
Yeah.
Okay, I will add the spotlight. All right. Oh, you added spotlight in your video.
It's okay now?
Now there is only one. I can see only you now. Okay. Now? This is fine. Yeah, we are fine now.
Okay. Yeah.
Good evening to everybody. And this is Prabhakar Rao here from the Art of Living Agriculture Trust. And I'm going to be just only answering question and answers. And I think this is one of those rare sessions where I am not presenting anything except I'm waiting for you to ask me questions, anything related to home gardening. I'm here to answer to the best of my abilities. I won't say that I'll answer everything, but I'll try my best to answer whatever you throw at me. So, but keep your questions related to home gardening because that's the focus of this. You know, agriculture is a huge topic. So if we want to use this effectively, let's focus on home gardening.
So we have completed the video session that we had planned for you. Will we move on to the question and answer session, Prabhakar ji?
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah. So these are the questions that I have received from a lot of people from the group. So I'll just ask you the most relevant and the appropriate questions which fit to our session today. So someone from the group is asking, how can they identify the organic vegetables in the open markets?
I think that's a beautiful question because the answer is going to be counterintuitive, you know. You know, when we go to the market, supermarket to buy vegetables, we have been programmed. How do you select a vegetable? How does your mind think when you go and see? You go and see tomatoes on the supermarket shelf. So you look for everything that is nice, very same shape, nice shiny skin, you know, and it's all looking nice and full, you know, there is no insects. It's all looking like it is manufactured in a factory. Yeah. So when you see tomatoes like that, you'll say, "Arey, beautiful tomatoes." Okay. Guaranteed that they are not organic. To get tomato like that, you'll definitely have to use hybrid seed. Hybrid seed, though, guaranteed. Otherwise, it will be a GMO tomato. And you would have used tremendous amount of agrochemicals. So while the tomato looks good, it is full of toxic residues. And it's unbelievable, Rahul, how much of toxic residues there are in the vegetables that we eat. It is mind-boggling. So actually speaking, if you go to a village mandi where, you know, where people are not using chemicals, like for example, we are doing this fabulous project in Aurangabad for the Adivasi tribals with the Ministry of Tribal Affairs. If you go to their shandi, which is their market, you know, every week they will have one shandi, you will find the vegetables. Each vegetable, if you are buying potato, one potato will be big, one potato will be small, one potato may be a little bit round, one potato will be a little bit misshapen, one potato may have one insect. Trust me, that is organic, because you know for sure that has been cultivated the way nature meant it to be cultivated. So very counterintuitive. You go to buy cauliflower, look, if there is one or two insects in that cauliflower, put it into your bag. Because if it is good for the insect, it is very good for you. That means nobody has used harmful pesticides like 4-8 and chlorpyrifos on that. Yeah. So it's counterintuitive. We are programmed to buy the best looking vegetable, but what we should be buying is actually the healthiest vegetable.
Yeah, I think they got the answer. Don't judge the book by its cover. I mean, don't judge a vegetable if it's like really red tomato. If it has insects, it can be organic. Okay, second question is, Prabhakarji, somebody is asking if they can use tea powder in home composting.
Oh, yes, absolutely. There is no issues as long as the tea. See, what happens? Tea has tannin in it. Yeah, in fact, tannin is one of the things that actually gives the color to the tea. But when you boil the tea, the tannin goes away. Yeah, so what you're left with is just the organic leaf, you know, of the tea powder, whatever. Actually, you can do very good composting with tea. There is no problem at all. Yeah. And in fact, a lot of people do that, you know, but only thing is, if you're using tea bags, you have to take it out of the bag. Yeah. And then compost it. You should take out that pin, you know, that staple pin and all that, you should take out and then do it properly. But otherwise, as a green input, for composting, no problems at all. You can use tea.
Thank you. Good question is, Prabhakarji, that someone saw your video on homemade jugaad. So the video says it has something that homemade jugaad has detergent or liquid soap as one of the ingredients. Is it harmful to consume vegetables after using it? They want some guidance on it.
Yeah. So what we are doing is the little bit of organic detergent that we put in there, it is only to emulsify. Yeah. So that detergent is not some toxic chemical which will go inside. Yeah. So what you do is you can use that spray, no problem. When you harvest the vegetable, anyway, you're going to wash it, because nothing has gone inside. So my biggest problem with agrochemicals like 4-8 and chlorpyrifos and melathion and all these toxic chemicals that people are using today, the chemical goes inside the sap of the plant. It goes into the cells of the plant and it kills the disease or the insect. So if the insect sits and sucks the juice is loaded with the chemical residue and with the chemicals and the insect dies. So that vegetable, no matter how much you wash it, the toxins are inside the vegetable. Whereas with the few drops of organic detergent that you use, no problem. Nothing is going to go inside. So you are very safe. And I can say this with a lot of confidence because I've eaten, I eat that a lot of my, in my, from my farm, most of the vegetables that I eat come from my farm. And up to now, it's okay.
Super. Okay. So many of them are asking even now in the chat, and we have the question even post before it. Many of them are asking how to make compost at home. If we have a quick steps of making compost at home.
So composting is a process that is a nightmare for home gardeners in India, because most of the YouTube videos that you have will talk about composting for the cooler climates. So if you just straight away go, so people talk about, you know, 6-to-1 carbon to nitrogen, greens to brown ratio. It is so confusing because most people don't understand that that composting system is for cooler climates. For tropical climates, we actually need a completely different system, which is called an anaerobic system. And I have an entire video on home composting. I will just play a bit that will be relevant to you. You can always go back to my YouTube channel is Prabhakar Rao. You just go in YouTube, type in Prabhakar Rao and my videos will pop up, and you can go to my home gardening hacks, yeah, home gardening videos. So in that there is one video on composting, and you can go through that. It's a very, very interesting video because I have really broken down this this technology for tropics like India, for tropical countries like India. And trust me, very, very few people in India really know how to compost. So very quickly, let me do a screen share and play that particular video of this thing. Okay, let me just take my desktop. That'll be better. Take Google. Home gardening hacks, composting. Okay, I'll just play a few minutes of this video and then we can continue from there. Somebody just give me a thumbs up if the audio and the pictures are okay. If it is not, just shout, give me a shout.
These things can form an entire topic by itself, because this takes us back to the Vedic agriculture and what we were doing for nearly 10,000 years in this country. But for now, let's focus on home composting during the lockdown. Now, when we come to composting, it's full of various terms: CN ratio, the browns, the greens, how much of carbon, how much of nitrogen. What is this magic figure of 30-to-1? Should composting be done outdoors in the sun or indoors in the shade? What does turning the compost mean? What is the 3-to-1 ratio that is touted all over the internet? Now, should composting be aerobic or anaerobic? Just there's thousands and thousands of questions. The more you Google on YouTube, the more confused you get with these terms. So let's start. Carbon is the browns and nitrogen are the greens. So the carbon to nitrogen ratio is extremely critical if you need to do good home composting. For tropical India, the 30-to-1 ratio is what is required. That is, your compost should ultimately have 30 parts of carbon to 1 part of nitrogen. It should be done in the shade, and it should be done without turning the compost. That means every now and then you don't have to turn around the compost so that the heated inside comes to the outside and the cooler outside goes inside. Now coming to the 3-to-1 ratio. Now this has baffled many a home composting enthusiast. 3-to-1 ratio does not mean you take any form of brown, 3 parts, and mix it with 1 part of green. Because in India, during home composting, we want to do it anaerobically, that is, without oxygen. Understanding this 3-to-1 ratio is very, very important for us. Now, what they don't tell you when they say 3 parts of brown to 1 part of green is that within each of these greens and browns, there is a ratio of carbon and nitrogen. That's not told to us. Kitchen waste has already got 25 carbon and 1 nitrogen in it. Dried leaves, 60 carbon and 1 nitrogen. Cut grass or grass clippings, 17 to 1 ratio. Shredded paper, 175 to 1. So if I am mixing vegetable waste and dry leaves, I need to combine the 25 carbon and 1 nitrogen in vegetable to the 60 carbon and 1 nitrogen in the dry leaves to get a final mixture of 30 carbon and 1 nitrogen. So suddenly it's become highly mathematical. How do I get to that magical number of 30 to 1 when I've got so many things to mix together? But don't worry, this is Jugaad technology at work. The best site on Google that I have found to calculate your browns and greens is if you Google the best compost calculator.
So Rahul, this is the site. You go to the best compost calculator. Actually, in my video, I have given the link and everything. Please don't worry about the math. Don't get confused. When you go to that calculator, all you have to do is to say, I have got this and this, and it will tell you exactly how to combine them. Once you get this 30 to 1 ratio of carbon and nitrogen, your composting will be a dream. You know, you can do such wonderful composting. And this video explores much further. It's a very detailed video only for Indian conditions. And I think this is the only video that there is on YouTube, which is specific to our conditions and our kind of waste. What we get as waste in our country, it is specific to that. So I think it's and using that calculator, हमें कुछ जुगाड़ ज्यादा सोचने का जरूरत ही नहीं है. You just go type in and it calculates and tell you. You take this much of the greens, this much of browns, and you're home and dry. Yeah. So I would suggest, you know, invest a little time going into this video and you will find a lot of information that will save you a lot of headache in composting.
Sure. We'll share the link of the video again. If anyone wants, we will share the link of the video again on the group. So no need to worry. We'll share the link. We'll go to the next question, Prabhakarji. Someone is asking from Kerala that they are facing the wrath of African snails, which are wreaking a havoc there. They grow up to the length of a palm and they eat any plant which is in front of them. Table salt kills them, but from one egg up to 40 snails come out. It is a menace there. Is there a way we can come up with a solution for this?
Yes. So we are talking about a farm or we are talking about home gardening? So
we are talking about, this is for farm. We'll, from the next questions, we'll keep it for the home gardening. But someone is asking, someone from Kerala has...
I will answer that as a one-off. The best hack that I have seen for snails, and these African snails are really a massive menace. You know, they are the size of frogs, Rahul, like toads, big. So they are this big, each of them. And they have a voracious appetite. They will come and overnight, you have a field of cabbage. Trust me, within one night, they can finish off that entire cabbage field. You know, it's frightening, you know, what they do. But the best hack that I have come across is something that is very, very easy. If you go to a pharmacy, you will get something called boric acid. They call it boric powder. Okay. Yeah. The best hack that I have found is take boric powder and draw a line, like a chalk line, chalk powder line, draw a boric powder line. Once you have taken out physically whatever snails are there in that farm, see if there are any snails inside, you're going to have a problem. So you take out all the snails and you can start putting this boric. One way of doing it is, if it's a small piece of land, is to put a circle around each plant, which works beautiful. But in a farm, you will have to make patches. You know, each bed, you will have to put this. But boric acid is like a Lakshman Rekha for these snails. They are very sensitive to this boric acid. If they sense that there is boric acid in front, They will not cross. And you can see in the morning, like a truck queue, you know, at a toll gate, all snails around that boric acid line. They're all lined up, but they won't cross. It's a very interesting sight. I have a video somewhere of that which I should post, but it's a good video blog to put, you know, how these, they're all waiting for this boric acid to dissolve or something so that they can enter. And they'll all be lined up, you know, around the farm. It's a fascinating sight, Rahul.
Okay. So this another question, and it's also like my question, that I don't get sunlight in my house. So how can I do home gardening, or which plants can I grow in this condition?
Correct. So we are all moving into apartment living, and in apartment living, this is a big problem because you may have one balcony, and that balcony may be like north facing or something. So you will not get much sun. Okay. First of all, let us break this down. Any balcony you have, okay, at some time of the year, you will get some light. So either in winter or in summer, you will get some light. So first of all, your 12 months, you have to divide. In some months, you will get 4 hours sunlight. Some months, you will get 2 hours sunlight. Some months, you will not get any sunlight at all. Okay. So what can you grow when there is no sunlight at all? This is the question that you are asking. When there is no direct sunlight, the things that you can grow are greens. Okay. So greens are what? You can grow, for example, spinach. You can grow fenugreek. That is like palak, methi, saag, amaranth. You can grow mint, pudina. It grows pretty well. You can grow chia. Chia grows pretty well. You can grow, for example, you can grow things like, what shall we say? Any of these herbal things, you know, a lot of these herbs where me like spearmint, peppermint, all these things you can grow very, very well. In fact, rosemary, thyme, if the temperatures are not high, yeah, like, you know, you have winter, no direct sun. These are all great things to grow. So when there is no sun, you can do this. Now, when you're getting about 2-3 hours of direct sunlight, you can get a little more ambitious. So when you get a little more ambitious, you can, you know, ease into things like, Aparjita. It's a beautiful, that blue tea that I have spoken to you about so many times. It'll flower very nicely and you'll get nice blue flowers. You can make tea, you can cook that thing, flowers. So you can do a little more ambitious thing. And if you're getting about 4 hours, you can actually do, you know, if you're getting 4 hours for about two, you can grow things like bush beans. Bush beans are a fantastic thing for a home gardener to grow because in 45 days, the whole crop is finished. Yeah. In 45 days from seed to harvest, everything is finished. So even if you're getting direct sun for a small window in 12 months, 1.5-2 months, you're getting direct sun. Bush beans you can do. You can do some of the cherry tomatoes. The cherry tomatoes are very nice. Yeah, they can actually good give you a decent yield even in low light conditions. Low light means about 3-4 hours of sunlight. You can do that. So you will have to first divide your 12 months into with which period, how much of sun you are going to get. Trust me, if you check 12 months, your balcony, there will be at least 2-3 months where you will get at least 4 hours of sun. Any direction you are in, yeah, you will get, yeah. So that's a start. And then, like I said, these are the kind of choices that you can start with. And then you experiment, you know, and yeah. it will happen, yeah.
100%. Thank you for such an insightful answer, Prabhakarji. A lot of questions that I got are also like farm related. So I just want to tell the participants here, you can send your questions on the chat box, which are home gardening questions. We'll do other sessions with Prabhakar. We'll try to organize more sessions, which have their specific context to it. So for now, you can just put your home gardening questions. So the next question is related.
There's a question here which says, if I get sunlight in the evening, can I? Of course you can. Evening sun is very good for our vegetables. So you can. Please go ahead. I'm so sorry to interrupt you.
No problem. So someone is asking that, are there any grow lights which are available in India?
Yes. We have Philips. who have a set of what they call plant lux lights. Yeah. So if you Google on Amazon, even on Amazon, you will get it. Yeah. Because today, a lot of people are doing hydroponic cultivation. And I have mentored a couple of them in Mumbai, where they are doing it in some old warehouses where they grow everything without sunlight. So they are basically, you know, growing fresh salad, salad leaves like lettuces, you know, pak choy, Swiss chard and things like that. So, and they're doing it entirely under light. Yeah. So I trust Philips of Holland overall, because I find their wavelength specificity to be good, especially in the red and the far infrared wavelengths. I think Philips has by far got the best technology in lighting. So you can use Philips Holland, yeah, those lights. They are available very freely today in the market in India.
Okay. Okay, Prabhakarji. So there are two questions which are connected. They are saying that they see a lot of flowers in the gardens, but the veggies are very less, like a one or two. So how to resolve this? And the other question says, how to make tomatoes with a lot of fruit in it?
Yeah. So, couple of things. One is, if you follow my Vedic agriculture techniques or natural farming techniques, this question will not come for you. Yeah. So, when you ask this question, you can be a little more specific about which crop you're talking about, or which particular variety of vegetable you're talking about. But generic, let me answer this. For example, if you take any of the cucumber family, yeah, or even tomato family or whichever, first the plant will produce a lot of flowers, yeah, especially in the cucurbits. If you observe the flower closely, they are all male flowers only. The female flowers will appear later. So a lot of people get discouraged. Arre, itna phool hai mere paude pe, but ek bhi kakdi nahi nikal raha hai isme. You know, and the flowers just drop off. No, I'm not getting any fruit. They get panicked. Yeah. But you must know that this is the nature's way of doing it. First, the nature will produce a lot of pollen in the air. Yeah. So once the male flowers have dominated and spread pollen, then you will start to get the female flowers. And then those female flowers will actually give you fruit. So you have to wait, because the plants will first flower. Initial flowers will not become fruits. See, it's like asking a 12-year-old girl to have a child. When the girl becomes 16 only, 16, 17 only, she will actually bear a child. Yeah. You get a girl who is not yet ready. She won't conceive a child, or I mean, she won't deliver a child properly. Right. It is like that. Plants have to become strong enough to bear fruit. Till then, the flowers will come, but the plant will not make fruit. The plant knows when it is ready to fruit, and at that time it will start fruiting. So in home gardening, the first thumb rule is just be patient. This is the first thing. Second thing is that to encourage the flowers to become fruits after, I'm not talking about that initial, when the fruits start forming, maybe a lot of fruits start falling and things like that. At that time, you know, I had given you a talk on bioenzyme, right, Rahul?
Yeah.
Bioenzyme application is very good. So at the time of bud formation, you can apply bioenzyme. And at the time when the fruits are just setting, you can spray bioenzyme. If you don't have bioenzyme, just gomutra. Yeah, gomutra is cow urine, desi cow urine, on a dilution of 1:100. You can spray it. Both of them will give good fruit set. But for home gardening, the ingredient you require is patience. If you are patient with your plant, the plant will give you tremendous amount of yield. Yeah, so be patient, first of all, and then you can use these foliar sprays, which are very, very useful also.
Super. So someone is asking specifically for tulsi plant. They are trying to grow tulsi plant in a pot, but because of no sunlight, it doesn't grow. So is there any solution for it?
So Tulsi is a very strange thing, you know, because Tulsi is a plant which cannot germinate if sunlight is not there. You know, normally seeds, they require to be covered with soil and only then the tulsi, the plant will germinate. If the sunlight is there, the seeds don't germinate. Yeah. And that is why we always keep our seed trays in a dark place till the germination starts. Even at home, you know, when you're making sprouts, you know, you will take a cloth, you will wet the cloth, you'll put all the, you know, moong or chana inside. And then you'll see the lady of the house keeping it in a dark place. Yeah, because they will germinate only if there is no sunlight. This is normal. But then you have seeds like chia. You've got seeds like tulsi, which we call sabja. Yeah, these seeds are very peculiar because they need sunlight. If they don't have sunlight, they will not germinate. It's a very peculiar thing. But and you will wonder, if I put my seed right on top, between waterings, it will dry up. But if you look closely at the seed, it's amazing what nature does. The moment you put the moisture to the seed, if moisture touches, that seed, it swells up. It will have like one cottony white coating, like a jelly, you know. That is how you make this, what do you call it? Falooda. You know, when you put falooda, you got this frog eggs, they call, you know. Actually, they are seeds which swell up and get a gelatinous coating. That gelatinous coating is the protection for the seed. It needs sunlight and it will keep the moisture and germinate. So first of all, if you're sowing tulsi seeds and you're not getting any plants from it, this is the first reason. Yeah. Second thing, tulsi plant requires some sunlight. Tulsi is not a plant that will grow in complete shade. Yeah. So best thing to do is, take that pot which you have with that small tulsi plant, keep it somewhere where there is, whether it's your terrace or whether some part, wherever you can, keep it for at least a month till it gets into a shape, you know, with a nice bush. And then you can bring it indoors to do your puja or pluck the leaves for making tea or offering to the puja, you can do all that. So tulsi is not a shade loving plant. First of all, we need to understand it's not a shade loving.
Sure, because it's even happening with me. I have a lot of green cover outside my balcony. So tulsi is not growing in the balcony. So yeah, thank you, Prabhakarji. Also, someone is asking that what's your experience of hydroponics farming? Do you recommend hydroponics?
For home gardening, there are a lot of hydroponic kits that are available these days. See, I am a little old-fashioned in this. I prefer to grow the way the nature wanted plants to grow. However, you know, you can try it out. I mean, it's a little novel thing. And I feel it's like, you know, it's like a little toy. And, you know, you see all this thing with a little motor and water going and without soil, something is growing. But the drawback of hydroponics is that ultimately you have to use chemicals. All the nutrition is given in as chemical, you know. So I am not greatest fan of that. Yeah.
Okay. Also, we'll take this last question from the sheet of questions that we got. Then we'll move to the chat questions that we have received. Someone is asking, is it possible to do farming with enzymes only?
No, you cannot. Just with enzyme, you cannot. See, enzyme does not have microbes in it. Bioenzyme, which you create, and I showed you, I think in your program, I gave the first ever hack for bioenzyme, right? How you can make it in 3 weeks instead of 3 months.
Yeah.
Yeah. So people can go back and watch that video. I don't know whether we put it on YouTube, but you know, bioenzymes do not have microbes. This is the first thing you have to understand. And our basis of natural farming and Vedic agriculture is to create the equilibrium of the nutrient solubilizing microbes in the soil. So just with bioenzyme, there is no way you can do farming.
Last question is organic cow dung manure better or chemical manure?
I think it's a given. As if you ask me that question, I will say always organic manure. But organic manure of just cow dung manure, by itself is not enough. You have to introduce the microbes. And that you can do only through bioformulations, which are based on our Vedic traditions. In fact, Rahul, I've just put out a link to my upcoming course on Vedic agriculture, which starts on the second or third, I think, September. So people can, register for this. This is a beautiful course where I talk about the principles of sustainable gardening, whether it's agriculture, whether it's home gardening. I'm talking about the principles which our ancient Vedic civilization, from 10,000 years, they were doing it successfully for 5,000 years, till 5,000 or 7,000 BC, whatever. We had a very sustainable method. It was based on a text called Vriksha Ayurveda. Yeah. And I explore that text, Vriksha Ayurveda. It's a very, very nice course for people to do, because when you're doing home gardening, you also need to know the principles, not really the solutions. You need to know the principles. Then you can make your own solutions, So I think it's worth that. So you can look at that particular thing also. Yes, Rahul, I've answered that.
Yeah. Thanks, Prabhakarji. It's for participants. It's like 1,000% recommended program for all of you. So for those who haven't tried the Vedic Agriculture Workshop yet, you can register for the upcoming one, which is from 3rd to 5th of September. You have the link in the chat box. I'll share the link on the WhatsApp groups as well. If anyone of you want more information for the course, you can ping me separately. And so we'll take questions from the chat box, Prabhakarji. So we'll only take these few selected ones and the appropriate ones for home gardening. Okay. So Abhi is asking that he wants to start microgreens in his garden in Nilgiris. So what are the steps that he has to follow?
Microgreens is one of the most beautiful things to do, as a home gardener, because it is very fast. You're talking about like within a week, you have a harvest ready. Two, it doesn't need light. It doesn't need light means, sort of direct sunlight and all that. It doesn't need soil. It doesn't need anything, So I have actually on my YouTube an entire episode on microgreens, how to grow microgreens. I have mentored people on microgreens as a micro entrepreneurship, startup model in agriculture, So I think it's a beautiful thing to do. It's very successful. And I think it's very good, during these COVID times to have these kind of things in the market, which are instant immunity boosters. Yeah. So microgreens, it's got great potential. And in the location that you're talking about, I think it's fabulous.
Super. So I'm just going to Divya is asking, how can she plant maximum plants in small apartment balcony? How to maximize space utilization in home gardening?
Yeah, I think Divya has asked a very, very sensible question, because first is to plan your planting calendar. In fact, if you do my Vedic agriculture course for North India and South India, I give you complete planting calendar every month what you should plant. So first thing you should know is, don't plant the wrong variety of vegetable. Don't plant it in the wrong season, because you will be consuming space, but the vegetable will not yield anything. Okay. Especially, for example, when you have things like climber beans. Yeah. Now climber beans are to be planted in a certain season. Otherwise they will just be leafy. They'll occupy a lot of space. Not one flower will come. Not one beans will come. It'll just keep on growing into a big bush. And it has taken all the space in your balcony, but you're not getting any vegetable out of it. So first thing is to ensure that you have a calendar of planting, and that calendar you maintain. So you know that in spring, let us say like, you know, like Chaitramas, you know, like our March, April, you know, spring, there is a plantation. So I have given for 12 Indian months, which are not actually overlap exact English months, but our from our Panchang, every Indian month from the Hindu calendar, what you can plant. Some you can plant throughout the year. So that is very good. So like, for example, if you take tomatoes, for example, especially cherry tomatoes, or you get desi tomatoes like desi Magadi tomato. It's a variety. What I like about this Magadi tomato is that all the tomatoes don't come to harvest at the same time. Yeah, it was a variety that I found in a village close to Bangalore. Not a village, it's actually a town, Magadi town. And the beauty is that it will keep on giving you, like, you know, every other day it will give you 2-3 fruits, which is ideal for home gardening. In home gardening, you don't want all the fruits to come at one time. Yeah, so like that. And then you have got, for example, bush beans. Yeah, bush beans are a fantastic thing for home gardener, because the plant is only so small. It's about 1.5 feet high. It's not big. Whereas creeper beans, when you plant, which all the seeds you get in the market are all creeper beans, hybrid creeper beans. So when you plant them, they occupy a lot of space. But bush beans in 45 days, a nice little plant, you have plucked your beans, you know, harvested it. It's so fantastic. So one planting calendar is very important. And if you plant according to that calendar, then you are optimizing the space. So you know, okay, bush beans, it will take only this much. Okay, if I'm growing a loki, then it needs so much of space. But I plant it in the season where in the next 2 months it is going to flower and fruit. You know, I don't keep it for 6 months waiting for it to flower and fruit. You know, so I think these are the kind of things the planning becomes. When you have small space, you should plan. And for that, you need a reliable planting calendar.
100%. Varsha D'Souza is asking that she wants method to make manure from kitchen waste.
Oh, yes. Just go to my episode on home composting and you will see one of my mentees, Divya Bajaj, take you through a beautiful home composting method where she just uses a clay pot. It is an anaerobic method which is suited to the tropics. And she just uses a clay pot and she does fabulous home compost. Please go and check that video out. It will answer your question.
Super. So you just need to go and type Dr. Prabhakar Rao on the YouTube search bar. You'll find many videos there. So one of the videos will be on home composting and you can check that out. Vishnu Bhatt is asking, Prabhakar ji, is there any natural growth promoter that you suggest?
Bioenzymes. Bioenzymes are very nice growth promoters. Gaumutra, which is cow urine, is an excellent growth promoter. In Vedic agriculture, I talk about Kunup Jala, which is again a fabulous growth promoter, and various experiments that I'm doing with fermented oil cake, which are excellent growth promoters. So there is much without using chemicals. There are wonderful growth promoters that we can look at for sure.
Okay. A lot of people on the chat box are asking if there is any place where they can get these seeds. So do you want them to lead them to somewhere to get these seeds?
Well, I mean, my own website, haryaliseeds.com, that's the website, www.haryali, it is double L, yeah, Haryali Seeds. So if you just go to Google and type Haryali Seeds, my website will pop up. It is a site where you can go. I have got more than about 100 vegetables there. You can go, you can order online, and I ship it by India Post. Every Thursday, I ship the seeds. And you can go. See, one thing that I have found in India is that reliable desi seeds are difficult to come by. You know, and I myself keep on buying seeds from many, many people in India just to check the quality. Because I want to recommend seeds to people. One of the good sites I find is Navadanya. Navadanya is run by Dr. Vandana Shiva. I mean, she is my mentor. She's a wonderful scientist, human being, and an activist championing for chemical-free farming. Navadanya has got a great selection of seeds. You could try our own agriculture trust of the Art of Living. And you know, you could order some seeds from there, especially medicinal. We are a lot now into medicinals. So we have a lot of medicinals which you can grow at home. You know, Ashwagandha, you can grow Mevanalli, you can grow Ram Tulsi, you can grow so many things, you know. So again, our website is trying to promote a lot of indigenous medicinals that you can grow. I would say that, you know, generally there are very, very few sites that provide reliable desi seed. And that's the problem, because then you go to the market and the only seeds you get in the market are hybrid seeds. And that's such a tragedy. Yeah.
Okay. So for all of you, you can go to SSIST. You can just type on Google SSIST. It's Shrishi Institute of Agriculture Sciences and Technology. You will find some of the seeds there. If you don't find the seeds which you want, you can go to Haryali, Dr. Prabhagaji's website
seeds,
as well.
Yeah, Haryali Seeds.
HaryaliSeeds.com. We have shared the website link on the chat box. You can just click it, or it's HaryaliSeeds.com. You can type it on Google. Rooftop Veggies, it's the username. He's asking that he's growing bitter gourd in the pots on his terrace, but he's having a lot of fruit fly problems. What can he do?
A lot of what problems?
Fruit fly problems.
Fruit fly.
Yeah.
Fruit fly.
Yeah. Fruit fly problems.
Yeah, fruit fly problems. Yeah. So the problem is, I suspect strongly that you're using hybrid seeds, because hybrid bitter gourd has got this problem. A lot of farmers have lost a lot of money. Usually desi bitter gourd seeds are very, very, very hardy, and they are quite resistant to fruit fly attack. But the best control that I have seen for fruit flies is to use what are called as fly traps. Yeah. So fly traps are this very colorful paper, colorful. You can say it's a little bit of a thickish cardboard sort of thing, or some kind of plastic material. Yeah, it's a little bit of a like a rectangle, which is very brightly colored. It's either very bright blue or it's a yellow, and it's got a very sticky surface. So hang a few of these around your plant and flies will get stuck to it. Yeah, so you can do that. And if you are having night insects, what you can do is you can hang these and put a small light, a small LED light, you know, you can put a blue light or something like that near that. Next morning, you will see this. So entire thing will be full of insects. Yeah. So I would say that use things like this instead of going and buying, you know, chlorpyrifos or some crappy toxic pesticide and trying to do that. Yeah.
Again, there are a lot of questions on composting. For all of you who want to know more about composting, we'll suggest you to go to Dr. Prabhakar Rao's YouTube channel. You will find a home composting video on the channel. You can look into it. If you have any questions after that, you can message us. Okay, the same
and
guy.
And also, you know, Rahul, if people go to the YouTube channel, what will be good for them is to, I know it sounds so cliched, but I'm saying it from the bottom of my heart. Subscribe to my channel, because every time now, I think I've reached that stage where every time I post a video, Google sends a notification to all the subscribers. So I've sort of inched myself into that category now. So what will be good is, because I keep on posting videos, I post videos about all kinds of things, and they will be very useful. A lot of them have to do with home gardening. So, you know, if you subscribe to that channel, it's always very nice. Yeah.
100%. So for all of you, it's like a free content hub on natural farming that you get. Just go to YouTube and subscribe to Dr. Prabhakar Rao's channel. So the same guy, Prabhakarji, Rooftop Veggies, he's asking that his plants are suffering from magnesium deficiency, especially his hibiscus. So the leaves are turning yellow. Is there any organic form of magnesium?
Yeah, so this is, who is asking this question actually? Who's the name?
The username is rooftop.veggies. I don't know his actual name.
Fair enough. Yeah. Okay, rooftop. I like that. Yeah. So first of all, you have to understand that in our natural farming or Vedic agriculture, we don't have this concept of mineral deficiency. Mineral deficiency is something, it's a myth that has been touted by the chemical farming, chemical, agrochemical industry, because your soil is bestowed with all the nutrients that a plant needs in abundance. But you need the nitrogen soluble, I mean, you need the nutrient solubilizing microbes to break them down and give it to the plant. So what you have is not a nutrient deficiency, you have a microbe deficiency, which can be easily tackled. You know, in natural farming and Vedic agriculture, we have beautiful solutions to bring microbes to your soil. Once your microbes are there in the soil, there is no question of any mineral deficiency. All minerals are there already in the soil, but they are in a bound form. You know, nature keeps it in a bound form, and it requires these microbes to come and split and release the nutrient to the plant. So our method of looking at it is not to look at something and say, oh, this is boron deficiency, this is magnesium deficiency, this is manganese deficiency, nothing. In natural farming, there is no question of deficiency because the soil is loaded with everything a plant needs. Yeah. So do, you know, look up these technologies like Vedic agriculture and natural farming, because we, our whole outlook to this is totally different. Go to my YouTube channel for the Bangalore International Center, BIC. I have given a talk on natural farming and explainer, where I talk about this myth called the soil test report, you know, the soil health card. I talk about the myth of the soil. It's a long video. It's about an hour and 45 minutes. But if you really want to know, go and check out that video. You'll get some very, very intuitive, very, very good insights into this entire myth called nutrient deficiency.
Super, super. I think we'll take last like 5-6 questions after this, because we are already 1 hour into the session. So we'll just take last 5-6 questions. So Rini Kumar, she's asking that, is the OP seed, open pollinated seeds, different from desi seeds, and which one is good to use for home gardening?
So lovely question, because, you know, a lot of people have got a whole confusion over this. Open pollinated seeds are desi seeds. They are the same. What is the character of OPC and desi seed? It only means you can make seed from seed. Say from Haryali, you buy, let us say, 10 seeds of cherry tomato. From that 10 seeds, you can make 1,000 seeds and sow them, and it will be the same cherry tomato. You can make seed from seed, which means you have to buy the seed only one time. This is the meaning of open pollinated varieties and desi seeds, the same thing. Hybrid seeds, you have to buy the seed every time. Every time you plant, you have to buy new seed from the market. That's how they make their money, no? See, in Haryali, there is no business model, because once I give you the seed, that's finished. You can keep on multiplying the seed, and that's what I want. I want you to save these varieties. I don't want you to keep coming back to buy from me. I want you to grow these vegetables. I want you to make seed, share it with your friends, so that these vegetables don't become extinct. Right? So OPC and desi seeds are the same. It means you are the seed keeper. You can multiply the seeds. No company, no corporation has a patent or a proprietary right over the seed. That is what it means.
Super. The next question is from Herleen Kaur. She is asking that how many plants can she keep in her room? She has more than 10 plants right now. Is it going to be dangerous because a lot of them would be producing carbon dioxide at night?
Yes. So she is possibly talking about indoor plants inside the room. Okay.
Yeah.
So let us look at this in a very, let's go back to the principles on this. Yeah. All plants produce oxygen during the day by taking in carbon dioxide. And at night, like any animal, they also take in oxygen and give out carbon dioxide. However, it's very, very slow rate. It's not like us, you know. If there are, you know, 50 people in a room, in a small room, you will suffocate. It's not like that. The plants, you know, they are very slow. So they will very slowly take. However, Pujya Gurudev Ravi Shankar ji, last year when COVID started, he announced a list of 5 plants, which he says are oxygen producing and immunity boosting plants. So I think, Rahul, I had shared this with you. It is also produced by the Sri Sri Tissue Culture Lab, which I have established. Yeah. And we have this beautiful set of five plants, you know, which you can take and use at home indoors. Because not only are these oxygen producing, of course, every plant is oxygen producing, but they are also immunity boosting. So Pujya Gurudev himself recommended the list of plants, and the tissue culture started to multiply it. And right now, you know, they have a lot of, they will ship it to anywhere in India. So if people who are really interested ping you, I will connect you with the head of our tissue culture lab, Dr. Gautam, and he will arrange the shipping for you.
Are these plants part of the Sanjeevani kit?
No, not the Sanjeevani kit. This is another one. Sanjeevani kit was something else. Those were, you know, Ayurvedic plants, medicinal plants, primary healthcare plants. This is not Sanjeevani kit. This is called the immunity boosting plant, indoor plants.
Okay. Okay. So next question, Vishnu is asking your opinion on trichoderm and Epsom salt in home gardening. Most of people are using it often now.
So we must again understand the principle. When we make bioformulations like Panchagavya, Jeevamrita, Kunabjala, Ganajeevamrita, and all this, trichoderma is already there. Okay, not just trichoderma. We have got all the bacillus species. We have got all the, we've got the entire taxonomic spectrum of the nutrient solubilizing microbes. So if you're following Vedic agriculture, you don't have to extra put trichoderma, extra put something else, extra put something else. These are all ways of fleecing home gardeners and farmers. You see, right now there is a huge industry called organic agriculture inputs. So people talk about organic flower booster. They are attaching organic to anything they are selling and trying to make money out of it. In Art of Living, in our agriculture trust, we teach that you please don't buy anything from the market, because you yourself can make the best possible bioformulation in a very simple way, and you can use it on your plants. Yeah. So you don't, please don't, I mean, trichoderma is what? Trichoderma is actually a fungus. And what does this fungus do? It's very interesting. I'll take 1 minute, Rahul, for this. See, the plants have roots. Okay, so if you take the total surface area of the root, that is its absorption zone. It's the absorption zone of the plant, and that much of nutrient the plant can take to grow. Trichoderma is what? It will go and attach itself to the root and then further become a web. It will further, you know, thin strands, like a internet highway, you know, you'll find thin strands of that fungus, which start to penetrate the soil. And the beauty is that this fungus will double, triple, or even 100-fold increase the surface area for root absorption, for nutrient absorption for the plant. The plant rewards it with nutrition so that the fungus gets reward every time it sends up a nutrient. So if you have, let us say, hypothetically speaking, 10 square meters of root surface area, trichoderma will make it 1,000 square meters of surface area. But it is a wonderful thing. It is a part of nature. But it's already there in our natural farming. It's already there in our Vedic agriculture. So why do we need to buy from outside and put? It's just a waste of money. Yeah.
Super. So Prabhakar, we'll take last 3 questions. For the remaining ones, maybe we'll try to organize one more session for them, or we'll figure out some way to answer their questions.
Yeah.
So the next question is there any alternative to Bijamrut?
Oh yes, there are several alternatives to Bijamrut. There is Bijamrut, which has to be made fresh. It has to be used within 24 hours. That's the disadvantage. So Ganajeevamrut, which you can even order on Amazon. It's something that has shelf life. So you can put Ganajeevamrut. It will give the same result. There is Panchagavya. Panchagavya also comes in a solid powder form and things like that, which you can use also. You can order on Amazon. It works well. Then, of course, you've got some wonderful formulations, which I'll explore in Vedic agriculture, like Kunabjala. Kutub Jala is an extraordinary thing, very counterintuitive, but those are all, they are, you can say they are the mother of all this, Panchagavya and all that. That's the original. 10,000 years ago, that's what our Vedic civilization used, Kutub Jala. And from there, all these derivations came out, you know, Panchagavya, then all the probiotic, for example, that also is a derivative from there. Then all this Jivamrit, Gana Jivamrit. It's, these are derivatives from the mother. Mother is Kutub Jala.
Okay. A lot of them again are asking about growth promoters. We'll recommend you to go to YouTube channel, Dr. Prabhakar Rao, and you'll find the videos there. Also, we did a series on our group, Prabhakarji, on the home gardening videos. So we shared 5 videos which were uploaded on your YouTube channel. So you can also go to the WhatsApp group and just scroll up and you can find the home gardening videos which I have shared. Okay, last 2 questions. Gauri is asking that seeds take a lot of time to germinate. Is she doing something wrong?
So seeds, what I always ask people to do when they do natural farming is when you are ready to plant, just do a treatment of Bij Amrit. See, Bij Amrit serves 2 purposes. One, it provides pre-soaking. A good idea for any home gardener is to put seeds into a tissue paper, fold the tissue paper, keep it in a moist place, wait for the seed to just germinate. It'll germinate very quickly. Once you don't plant it, you just put it in this thing, wet place, it will germinate very quickly and then plant it. Yeah. But if you are doing a Bij Amrit treatment, which is basically dipping the seeds in this Bij Amrit, A, you have provided the moisture, which is going to make the germination much faster. 2, you've provided the inoculum of the microbes required by the plant. So as soon as the first root, that radical comes out, at that time itself, the association between the microbes and the plant starts. And the plant will grow very beautifully. Yeah. So I always advise, you know, a Bij Amrit treatment. It's very easy to make Bij Amrit. It's very easy to do the treatment, you know. You just take a little cloth, put the seeds in it, just make a little potli and then dip it. Just leave it there for 2 hours, take it out and you can directly plant it, or you can dry it in the shade and you can plant it, or you can store it also. There is no problem. Yeah.
A lot of them on the group are asking about micro deficiency and if we can organize an exclusive session on that topic. So we'll try to do as many sessions as possible for you all. So we'll end with this last question, Prabhakarji. It's not directly related to home gardening, but it's a question that many of them want to know. That what's the difference between natural farming and permaculture?
Yeah. So permaculture is a way to create soil. Yeah. It's one of the most beautiful ways of creating soil. So suppose you have a farm where it's all rocky. It's like our farm permaculture in Art of Living. If you went there about 20 years ago, and I have been there 20 years ago, I've seen it develop year on year. I have seen how it has transformed. At that time, it was just sheet granite. There was not even 2 inches of soil in that place. It was just rock. And Gurudev allotted this land and said, okay, do permaculture. Okay. Permaculture, over the years, we have created now soil where we can grow fruits, we can grow vegetables, we can grow all kinds of things, and it is rich. What is permaculture? Permaculture is how you make soil. Okay. And then you made soil, and then. So permaculture is something where you have either very degraded lands or you have got rocky sheet land. And you want to do gardening. So permaculture, that is the fundamental principle of permaculture, where you make soil. That's the thing. Natural farming is when you have soil. So already in your field, you have soil. Then you don't go permaculture route. You go natural farming route because you have soil already. You don't have to create soil. But you start to introduce the microbes. You do mulching. You do desi seeds. All these things will come together for you to do sustainable agriculture. When you have soil, you don't have soil, go permaculture.
Super, super. Okay, so thank you Prabhakarji, it is always wonderful to have you in our sessions, and I know everyone would be feeling the same. So yeah, if you want to conclude with something, please share.
No, nothing much. I am very, very grateful because Rahul, you know, he is the one who keeps, in fact, even renaming my videos. I had so many videos. He was the one who pushed me. He says, let's make a sequence. Let's name them. Let's number them. So thank you, Rahul. You've always been a great source of, you know, strength for me. And, you know, it's a result of his pushing that I actually sort of made it a little more user-friendly. Otherwise, I have so many videos, you know, on my channel that, you know, it's all scattered all over the place. So thanks to Rahul, I do this. I really love this group because I find this group to be a very loyal, keen and serious home gardeners. So I think we can have more episodes where we'll take one topic at a time and explore. And I think that 100%. Itself will become a great archive of information, you know.
Yeah, I think that was super. That's the plan. We'll love to do so on the groups. So you're welcome, Prabhakarji, for all the kind words that you shared. I will love to contribute more in this space if you need any help. Also, guys, if you like the session, I mean, you just keep engaging with us. You keep messaging us what you want to learn. And we'll try to figure out some way to organize sessions around those topics. Or maybe you can just share it on Instagram. If you like this session, you can share it. You can go on Instagram if you want. You can tag Dr. Prabhakar, or you can tag me. You can tag Art of Living and share your experience. This would encourage more people on social media to join the farming community. So just go on Instagram or any social media if you want. You can tag Dr. Prabhakar and share the experience of the session that you have. That's it, I think, Prabhakarji. Thank you so much for giving your time. Also, we have an upcoming Vedic Agriculture workshop from 3rd to 5th. We have the link in the chat box. I'll share the link on the group. For those who want to participate in the workshop, they can just go to the website and enroll for the workshop. You can message me personally if you have any queries. Thank you, Prabhakarji. Thank you, everyone, for attending the session.
Thank you so much, Rahul. And thank you, guys. I will be with you soon. Jai Gurudev.
Jai Gurudev.